you can go without touching the floor. Whoa! Okay, and then when I count to three, we're gonna jump up all together as high as you can. You guys ready? One, two, three.
Good morning, beloved. As we come together in our time of isolation still, as we worship online, let us worship together in the house of the Lord. As we sing, they'll know we are Christians by our love.
Good Samaritan. I wonder if this is a parable. It might be. Parables are very precious, like gold. This box is gold. It looks like a present. Parables are like presents. They have already been given to us. We can't buy them or take them, or steal them. They are already ours. There's another reason why this might be a parable. It has a lid. And sometimes, parables seem to have lids on them. But when you lift the lid, of a parable, there's something very precious inside. I know. Let's take off the lid and see if this is a parable. I wonder what this could be. It's brown and rough. I wonder what such a brown place could be. I wonder what this could be. I could put one end here and another over here. Wonder what it could be. Let's see if there's something else here that can help us. There are these. Once there was someone who said such amazing things and did such wonderful things that people began to follow him. One day, a lawyer asked him, "What is the most important law?" And he answered, "You already know." The lawyer said, "Yes, we are to love God and love our neighbors. But who is my neighbor?" So he told a parable. A person was going from Jerusalem to Jericho, and robbers came and attacked him and hurt him and took everything that he had and left him by the road. Half dead. A great priest from the temple in Jerusalem was going down the road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. A Levite, a person who also worked in the church at the temple, was going down to Jericho too. When he saw him, he passed on the other side. But a Samaritan, who wasn't from the same country, came to where he was. And when he saw him, he had compassion and went to him. He put medicine and bandages on his cuts and put him on his donkey and brought him to an inn and stayed with him all night. He told the innkeeper that the man could stay until he was well and he would pay for it all. Now, which one of these three was a neighbor to the person who was hurt and robbed and left by the side of the road, half dead. I wonder if the person who was left by the side of the road had a name. I wonder who was a neighbor to the robbers. I wonder how you can be a neighbor to others. Let's have a prayer. Hands together, in our laps, heads bowed. Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you for the story of the Good Samaritan.
Thank you for the story of the Good Samaritan.
Thank you for parables.
Thank you for parables.
And for teaching us how to be a good neighbor.
And for teaching us how to be a good neighbor.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you for listening to our story. We love you and miss you. Bye, guys.
Touches a valley,
all the clouds are taught to fly,
as our souls shall leave this land
most peacefully.
So now keep in mind all of those, of course, whom you hold concerns for in our time of prayer. And so now let us pray. We confess, O God, that there are times when we secretly love that unpublished hymn entitled, "Sit Down, O Men and Women of God, There Is Nothing That You Can Do." Yes, Lord, we admit that at times we'd like to wring our hands and sit in a cloud of complacency, feeling sorry for ourselves and blaming others when our lives go south on us and our faith seems futile and our faith seems strange, and we have a sense of comfort from feelings of futility. For playing the blame game exempts us from responsibility and gives us a perverted sense of power. And yet, O Lord, faith futility is basically a cop-out. It is practical atheism. It is a knee-jerk reaction to fail to do justice and to love mercy and to walk humbly with you. So faith without works is dead. And we are never really healed or helped by our negative feelings, O Lord. But we find our spirits lifted and our legs strengthened as we are able to love our neighbors as ourselves. We rejoice in the fellowship of the church and in the spirit of worship that is in truth and in spirit, and it lifts us. And we hear the summons then of Jesus to us to be light of the world and salt of the earth. Thus, O Lord, when we hear of floods and destruction and disruption in our community, our state, our world, we are strengthened. Because we shared in the Week of Compassion offering this past February with thousands of other disciples in the United States and Canada. And so this very day, resources are being used to ease burdens in Oklahoma and around the world. And our faith is stronger because we rose up and acted with compassion in February. And this past week, we rose up in faith and gave a friend a pat on the back and a shoulder of support in their need. We joined then with the Spirit of Jesus, who commands love, and who ask us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Hear these words from the Gospel of Luke. Just then a lawyer stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he said, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" He said to him, "What is written in the law? What do you read there?" The lawyer answered, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." And Jesus said to him, "You have given the right answer. Do this and you will live." But wanting to justify himself, he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" Jesus replied, A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell into the hands of robbers, who stripped him, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. Now by chance a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came near to him, and when he saw him, he was moved with pity. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on them. Then he put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, "Take care of him, and when I come back, I will repay you whatever more you spend." Which of these 3 do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers? The lawyer said, "The one who showed him mercy." Jesus said to him, "Go and do likewise." The word of the Lord for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Recibi vivimus, para el vivimus, y si morimus, para el morimus, sea que vivamos o que muramos, somos del Señor. Del Señor. When we are living, it is in Christ Jesus, and when we're dying, it is
talking today about the Good Samaritan, the parable that Jesus told long ago. And what else can I say about this parable? It's been around a long time. It's become one of the most cherished of all the stories that Jesus told. And people have been talking about it and telling and retelling it for almost 2,000 years now. I would venture to say it's definitely one of the top five stories of Jesus, maybe even the top three. And it has changed the world. I truly believe that it's changed the world. This one simple story has power in it that has made a difference. The big word in the story is the obvious one, Samaritan. In Jesus' day, putting good with Samaritan seemed contradictory to the people Jesus was surrounded by. It was kind of like saying a righteous devil. The two things didn't fit together because they had a very negative view of Samaritans. But Samaritan has transformed through time. It means something different now. When we hear the word, it's often attached to a hospital. I took a quick look on the internet. I found in 21 states there are hospitals and clinics that are called Good Samaritan. And I also found there are a couple in faraway India. There are also laws that have been passed to promote positive things, like saving people's lives and feeding the hungry. In religious organizations such as the Catholics, the Episcopals, and the Lutherans, there are organizations named Good Samaritan. That's not too much of a surprise. There are even colleges named Good Samaritan. So Good Samaritan has transformed greatly. It reminds me of the Scarlet Letter, which we were forced to read when I was in school. Perhaps you were in on that fun too. In that, which is considered a great masterpiece of literature, a woman is forced to wear a scarlet letter, A, upon herself at all times. And in the beginning, the A is supposed to symbolize her sin, which was adultery. And everywhere she went, people would see that, and they were supposed to understand that she was a sinner. But as time goes by, the meaning of the letter that she wears, it transforms. It now comes to mean something positive. The word Abel. It says in the book, the letter was the symbol of her calling. Such helpfulness was found in her, so much power to do, and power to sympathize, that many people refused to interpret the scarlet A by its original signification. They said it meant able, so strong was Hester Prynne with a woman's strength. So as she lived among people and lived positively, that made more of an impression on them than this unusual A that she wore upon her clothing. So it's transformed in that way. What used to be a negative connotation when people first heard the story of Jesus has now transformed into something very positive. And if we say a bad Samaritan now, that's when we will get people's attention. And there is, I understand, there are some works of fiction that have used bad Samaritan. I don't know if they've used it successfully, but they have used it. It's human nature that we want to protect ourselves, and we build walls around ourselves, and we create divisions between us and other people. We've done that for a long time in many ways. Well, Jesus lived in a culture that was a human culture, like ours, that had some of that going on. And that's what the Samaritan
business was all about. They were saying, Samaritans are not insiders like us. Jesus did not merely accept that. He used it and was challenged by it and challenged the notion and radically in the process redefined the word neighbor. Neighbor's another big word in this story. For me growing up, you know, a neighbor was simply someone who lived on our block. I didn't really think of it as any more than that. Maybe someone would get my attention at Sunday school, maybe not. I remember our next door neighbors seemed a little more important to us than the ones that lived further down the block. We were closer to them, literally and figuratively. For some reason, well, we knew them a little better. We trusted them a little more. This is not what Jesus is trying to teach. He's trying to get us to stretch our hearts and our minds to something far bigger and to see that a neighbor can apply to anyone and that we should not limit someone's ability to be a neighbor to us based upon anything less than the goodness that they have inside and that they are a child of God, even as we are. Our general minister and president of the Christian Church Disciples of Christ has issued a statement and did so through YouTube. And I want to share that with you, not in full video format, but the audio there for you to hear. And want to acknowledge that we are going through an unusual time, and she is speaking on behalf of the church to get our attention about the things around us. And so it fits in very well with what we're talking about today when we talk about the Good Samaritan parable and what it means to us. So let's listen to Terry Horde Owens as she speaks to us, the church.
Hello, disciples. This week marks a grim milestone in the U.S. Over 100,000 lives have now been lost to the COVID-19 virus. This weekend, Christian, Muslim, and Jewish faith communities will offer lament in their worship services on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. And I invite you and your congregations to offer lament in your Sunday worship, not only to mark this profound loss of life, but to stand in solidarity for the health and safety of our communities. This week, another black man, George Floyd, was killed when a police officer in Minneapolis pressed his knee into Mr. Floyd's neck, even though Mr. Floyd repeatedly said, "I can't breathe." For 7 minutes, the police officer pressed his knee into Mr. Floyd's humanity and killed him. So, disciples, if we say that we are a pro-reconciliation, anti-racism church, we must choose every day to do the things that are necessary to be who we say we are. And that means not only standing up, but speaking up and acting in solidarity without fear. Those first believers in the upper room on that Pentecost were empowered and emboldened by the Holy Spirit to not only tell the story, but to reimagine themselves as community and to reimagine themselves as followers of Jesus in relation to a wider community. They knew Jesus. But it wasn't until the Holy Spirit came that they had the power and courage to do what was necessary to be who they said they were and who Jesus called them to be. There is a song by Harold Melvin in the Blue Notes called "Wake Up, Everybody." The chorus of that song ends with these words: "The world won't get no better if we just let it be. We gotta make it right, you and me." May you feel the fresh wind and fresh fire of the Holy Spirit empowering you, emboldening you, giving us all courage to do what is necessary to be who we say we are.
Author Reggie McNeil writes about the parable of the Good Samaritan in his book called Get Off Your Donkey. He says that the moral of the story is that you have to get off your donkey if you're going to help anybody. When we come around this table at Christ's invitation, we are called to remember to get off our donkey. Even in a time of pandemic and isolation, we are called. As individuals and as a congregation, we may not be able to solve world hunger, but we can help feed those around us in need. We may not be able to find transportation for everyone in the world, but we can provide bicycles so that those in Oklahoma can get and keep a job and possibly make a better life for themselves. We are disciples first, followers of Jesus. As we prepare to partake of this bread and this cup, let us get off the proverbial donkey and remember to love all the people. Jesus took bread and he blessed it and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples and he said, "Take and eat of this, all of you, for this is my body, broken for you. Remember." He also took a cup and he said, "Drink of this, all of you, for this is the new covenant in my blood poured out for the forgiveness of your sins." Drink as often as you come around this table and remember. For as often as we eat this bread and we drink this cup, we do remember. We remember the lessons that Jesus taught us in the parables. We remember the life that he lived, the death that he died, and that he was risen to Christ, to life eternal. Let us partake. Amen. As a time of invitation, you are invited to get off your donkey. You're invited to love all the people as we sing together, "I am the light of the world."
I am the light of the world. You people come and follow me. me. If you follow and love, you'll learn the mystery of what you were meant to do and be.
We would like to remind you that you can give to the church online through Givelify. You can go to the church website to do that, or you can give by sending in a check to the P.O. Box for the church, P.O. Box 18636, Oklahoma City, Oklahoma 73154. Our ministry does matter, and the work of the church continues. Even though we are not worshiping in one place, we are still being the church together. Let us be called to love all the people. Amen.
Since I started for the kingdom, since my life he controls, since I gave my heart to Jesus, the longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows. The longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows. The more that I love him, more love he bestows. Each day is like heaven, my heart overflows. The longer I serve him, the sweeter he longer I serve him, the sweeter he grows. The more that I love him, more love he bestows. Each day is like heaven, my heart overflows. The longer I serve him, the sweeter he
Jesus is there.
For Jesus is there.